It's the power of hope.
The power, power of hope.
Center of Christ.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. This is the best place I can think of to be in at this moment. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Jesus' presence is always a good place to find ourselves in.
Amen.
We welcome everyone here today. We really appreciate you coming out and fellowshipping, because fellowshipping is very important.
Amen.
I don't know if there's anything more important that pleases our God Almighty than his believers coming out and fellowshipping together.
Amen.
We just pray that you receive a blessing today. We pray that the Holy Spirit will touch your hearts.
Amen.
We pray that the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, his word
Thank
and his
Lord.
Message
Thank
will be
Lord.
Spread far
Thank you, Lord.
From this place called
Glory
Hope Center
God.
Of
God.
Christ.
Amen.
Enjoy the service and enjoy
Amen.
Worshiping the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Dear Heavenly Father, in the name
Thank
above
you.
All names, your Son Jesus Christ,
Amen.
We welcome you here
Thank
today.
God.
Thank you, dear Heavenly Father, for you drawing us unto you.
Thank
in your
you,
precious
Lord.
Name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Good morning. Go ahead and turn in your songbooks to page 63 for our first song, Praise Him. Again, that's page 63.
We're going to praise the Lord, Hope Center. Hallelujah to the King of Kings. Here we go.
Praise the Lord, all ye nations. Praise him. Extol him, all ye people from everywhere. Praise the Lord, all ye nations. Praise him. Extol him, all ye people from everywhere. Praise the Lord, all ye nations, praise him. Extol him, all ye people from everywhere. Praise the Lord, all ye nations, praise him. Extol him, all ye people from everywhere.
For great is his love.
For great is his love toward all of us, and his faithfulness endures forever.
Praise him.
Praise him.
Oh, his love's great toward all of us.
And for our next song, go ahead and turn in your songbooks to page 38. For I can do all things.
Pastor Again, that's Harold, page 38. I'm just going to ask you quickly. Does anybody need a songbook? Can you get one song or two songbooks?
Go ahead and raise your hand
if you need one. Yeah, he'll get you one. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
God's word says in Philippians 4:13 that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Amen?
Amen.
And then it says, my God shall supply all my needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
I can do all things. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. That you need today, that you need the Lord to provide. Come on, raise your hand if you need something today that you need God to provide. Well, my hand's up, and I'm trusting that God says that I can do all things. So let's just claim that each and every one of us, that the Lord will work through us and he will complete what he started in your life. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
I can do all things. Praise the Lord. Here we go.
Yes, Jesus.
Come on, let's rejoice in the Lord together. And let's sing this song in faith. Hallelujah. Do it. Your word says I can. Ooh. Come on, let's sing, Hope Center. Jesus, through the
Thank you, worship team. You may be seated. Well, okay, we just sang, I can do all things.
Amen.
What is that one difficult thing? It might not even be impossible, but you've let it become impossible. In your mind, it's become bigger and bigger until now you think, oh, I'm not even going to bother trying to do that this week. Anybody? No, because we can do all things, yes. All things, yes. Through Christ who strengthens us,
Amen.
Right?
Thank you, Lord.
And you say it with me,
I can
do all
things through Him,
things through Him,
who strengthens me, you.
Amen.
Got it?
Amen.
In preparation for Pastor Harold's message, he's asked me to read this morning from Psalm 27, and I didn't see my note until very late from him. He sent it in time. I didn't read it in time, so I'm reading from my Bible, and I have to use these, okay? So I know, I'm a little vain, which I can do a whole message on that one, Ecclesiastes, and it's a good one. It's a good message. Maybe if you remind me, I'll do it. All right, Psalm 27. The Lord is my light and my salvation.
Hallelujah.
Whom shall I fear?
Amen.
All right.
The Lord is a stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?
Amen.
When the wicked advance against me to devour me,
yes.
It is my enemies and my foes who will stumble and fall. Though an army besiege me, my heart will not fear.
Yes.
The war break out against me, even then I will be confident. One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek Him in His temple. Right. For in the day of trouble He will keep me safe in His dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of His tabernacle and set me high upon a rock. Then my head will be exalted above the enemies who surround me. At His tabernacle, I will sacrifice with shouts of joy. I will sing and make music to the Lord. Hear my voice when I call, O Lord. Be merciful to me and answer me. My heart says of You, seek His face. Your face, Lord, I will seek. So, Lord, do not hide Your face from me. Do not turn Your servant away in anger. You have been my helper. Do not reject me or forsake me, God, my Savior. Though my father and mother forsake me, the Lord will receive me. Teach me Your way, Lord. Lead me in a straight path because of my oppressors. Do not turn me over to the desire of my foes. For false witnesses rise up against me, spouting malicious accusations. I remain confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living.
Amen.
Wait for the Lord. Be strong. Take heart.
Amen.
And wait for the Lord. This is God's word in preparation for Pastor Harold's message. I would like to give an announcement this morning. Now, some of you have been hearing, and as have I, lots of different confusing messages from our various governments in terms of our COVID protocol. And as you know, we have taken the stance of following God's scripture and being submissive to those whom God has put in authority over us.
Amen.
So who has God put in authority over us here? It's California. All right? It's not necessarily the federal government, but it's California. That's who we have to submit to here at Hope Center of Christ. And so that's what we have done, and we have seen that God has blessed us as a result of following that word. And I have to say, I want to say a very personal message from me to you, this congregation, a message of gratitude, because I have seen so many churches divided over what to do and what not to do and how to conduct ourselves as a church during these very difficult and confusing times. Amen. And as I have led as closely as I can and following and hearing the Lord's voice as closely as I possibly humanly can, what I have heard and seen, that even though I know many of you personally in your different positions on how, on whether or not we should resist government or submit to government, and I know that there are churches who have resisted. We took a submissive stance, and as I've said before, I have nothing but utmost respect for all churches, whatever position they have taken, because I believe that most of them have sought to do God's will for their church. We can only do what we believe God wants us to do at our church. And I'm not going to judge any other pastor or any other church for taking a different stance than we've taken here. That's number one. Number two, I know so many of you have had different positions in terms of whether or not to wear masks or not, whether to be vaccinated or not. And this church, there are different positions within this body of Christ. And all of us, what we've tried to do is to say, whatever protocol will make the most people feel comfortable is what we will do. Because we wanted as many people to be able to come to church and feel safe as possible. And I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for doing that, for staying so, so united as a church. And so many of you have been willing to wear face masks even though you don't want to, but you've done it to bring unity to this church. And I want to thank you for doing that. Some of you have chosen to be vaccinated. Some of you have chosen not to be vaccinated. That's between you and God. It's not us as a church to tell you what you should or should not do. But the reality is that some people have different positions, and that's okay, because these are very confusing times, and I'm not going to be here, and I'm not going to stand up here and say, oh yeah, I think this is the right way to go in terms of those things. That's not my call as your pastor. My call is to lead you to the Lord.
Amen.
Pure and simple. But the point is, now we've been hearing the message that the CDC has said, CDC, Center for Disease Control, has said that we can, that if you've been vaccinated, you no longer have to wear a face mask. That is what I've been hearing. And I'm going to ask you as a church to continue to take the position of unity and what will help us stay unified as a church for a few more weeks. Because as of June, the Sunday, June 20th, that's post-June 15th, if all things continue as they are, we should be able to worship here with no more restrictions at all. That's only 4 more Sundays from now. So I'm going to ask all of you to continue to do what you've been doing, to put your desires aside, your personal desires aside, to come together in unity as a church. What I'm getting to is, I don't want people to feel, if they don't want to be vaccinated, that they're going to be judged if they come wearing a mask or not. That's my concern. I don't want anybody to feel judged. I don't want anybody to feel afraid or not wanting to come to church.
Amen.
Because they'll think, well, if I wear a mask, they're going to think I haven't been vaccinated, and that's their choice, and I respect that choice. So I'm asking all of us to continue to wear masks, regardless of whether or not you've been vaccinated, for 4 more Sundays, in the name of unity as God's church. So I hope that you can all, I believe that God is asking us to do that. It's a way of showing we love each other.
Amen.
Right?
Yeah, of course.
Because it has a small price to pay to wear a mask. We're all tired of wearing them, believe me. Believe me. So, I know I've already been Can you believe it? I thought I would never say this. I thought I was going to be feeling like, oh my, I don't have a mask on. Oh my, I don't have a mask on. And yet twice this week, I started to go into a grocery store without my mask. And I was like, oh, well, okay. I guess I'm not going to have any trouble getting rid of that when the time comes. All right. So that's it. So thank you, everybody. Thank you very, very, very much. And I just want to thank you also for your tremendous support for our church. That's what I want to say. And it's time for us to take the offering now. Of course, we will be able to pass the offering plate again on June 20th. While I'm at it, I better talk about June 20th. That's Father's Day, right? We just had this wonderful Mother's Day last week, and thank you, Jim Ross and Rosemary, for the wonderful flowers to all the ladies. Can we give them? They're not here, but we can thank them. Jim travels for work many weekends, so if he's not here, that's where he is. He's working. So anyway, but June 20th is Father's Day. That'll be the first Sunday. God willing, we'll be able to lift all restrictions. And it's Father's Day. It is also going to be the baptism of the triplets.
Oh.
So I wanted to give you guys a heads up. So I will have to, like I did for Mother's Day, I will have to reserve a few seats up front for those who are participating in the church service so that we can make sure they can actually get up here and be here. So there'll be time. So we're going to have to reserve a few seats for the babies and their family and also the godparents. So that, and then, but there will be other people coming for the baptism, I guarantee you. So we will have overflow in the garden, but any rate, but there'll be more room in the church. We'll be able to seat more of you in here, okay? So, but that's a heads up. All right, that's enough of my announcements. So, that time of offering now, we have our box, or you can give electronically or send your tithe to our post office box. We've been picking it up and getting those deposited. And so, it's at hopecenteroc.org. If you want to donate via PayPal, which I like to do, or send the address to our post office box is on there, which my husband likes to do, although now he likes to put it in the offering box. So let us pray. Oh, God, this is your church. You have said that this is the apple of your eye. You've told me repeatedly, don't worry about how many people are there, because those who are there are my beautiful, powerful remnant. So we thank you, Lord, for this church. We thank you for what you are doing here. We thank you for the deep, strong, healthy roots that you continue to build here at Hope Center of Christ.
Thank you,
Lord, for these people, their dedication, being willing to come together as one body, your body. No division. Nobody saying the head is better than the foot or the hand is better than the eye, whatever. No, we're all one. All one. Unified by you. Thank you, Lord. And I ask now, Lord, that as we give our tithes to you, I want to thank you, Lord, for the continued financial blessing and providence that you have given to the members of this church. Thank you. I've seen it and I've heard it story after story, testimony after testimony. And I ask, Lord, that you continue to do so. Continue to provide for them. Continue to heal them. Continue to guide them and show them where you need them most. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. And I ask you now for a hand of protection over this, your church. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Go ahead and turn in your songbooks to page 56 for Lord, You Are Holy. Again, that's page 56.
disrupts the atmosphere. We need a song that God can hear. A song that exalts the King of Kings. A song that all nations would come together and sing. That song is
bless his name.
Lord, you are holy.
Amen and amen and amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Jesus, I believe what God is saying to us is that we don't have to wait for His Spirit. He wants us to be alive in His Spirit whenever you want to be, in the name of Jesus. That is a free gift to us. That is part of the victory that we received from Jesus Christ, His Son. Amen. Amen. Today we're going to be talking about the face of God. The face of God. And of course, knowing me, I'm going to go around in circles before I get to where I need to be. God has made me that way, and I make no excuses for it. Amen. Like, here's going around in circles before I get to the message. I believe that there is someone in God's house that have been searching for the face of God, and they have seen the face of God, but they have not recognized the face of God. There is someone in this house that need to receive a healing from God. They have gone to God in prayer. They have gone to Him on their knees. And they have to just claim their healness, their wellness in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Here's another going around a circle. There are some of you that are looking for a job. There are some of you whose bills are unpaid. There are some of you that feel lonely or not a part of mankind or part of the fellowship. I'm here to tell you right now, as you sit in God's house, you have everything you need. In the face of God, if you look to your right, you look to your left, or you look towards the front or back, when you look into fellow believers' eyes, you are looking into the face of Almighty God. Amen. That is one reason why it's so important that we fellowship. That we fellowship. Amen. Amen. This wasn't a part of my message either. And the woman don't even know she gave me a part of my message. Today, yesterday, we were walking out on the bird sanctuary. And I don't know, I might have looked like a bird watcher. But the woman said, "Sir, have you seen the birds?" I said, "No, I didn't see the birds." She said, "Well, they're all out here. They are beautiful." And this is how it became a part of my message. How many times have we not seen the beauty of God? If I ask you, "Sir, ma'am, sir, young man, have you seen the face of God?" You say, Well, no, I have not. Wow. I said I must tell the congregation that we must be on the lookout for the face of God. In our world today, we are being distracted by a woke generation. We are being distracted by CRT. We are being distracted about XYZ chromosome, LMPQRS. We are being distracted. And that is not supposed to go on, because there's only one face we're supposed to look at, and that is the face of God. Amen. Amen. If I'm stepping on toes, forgive me. But one thing I don't want is God's church to become a place where all people are doing are complaining. I want God's church to be a place where you're seeking the word of God. That is one thing that we do at Hope Center of Christ. Some of you, I heard the seat cracking as the pastor was reading the word today. It was long, because we have become so accustomed to reading one verse, maybe two verses, maybe three, but 14 verses? My goodness, that is taking a license, as far as some of us may feel, that we are taking a license and we are abusing it. But let me share with you, the word of God, if you hear nothing else, make sure you're hearing the word of God. Make sure you put yourself in the presence of Almighty God. That is all that matters. Regardless of what I say here today, if you don't get the word of God, all you've heard is a clanging cymbal. All you've heard is a big, loud mouth. Amen? Amen. And so I'm finished. Not the message, but keep your eyes on Jesus, folks. Everything is going to be all right. All this stuff they're trying to throw at you and make some of it stick, just kick it off and put your eyes back on Jesus. He's the same today, yesterday, and forever. He does not change. This is not the first time in society over the 4,000, 6,000, how many ever years, this is not the first time that man has been distracted. I mean, they had idol worship then. They got it now. They had baby sacrifice then. We have it now. So, but the one thing that remains constant is Jesus. It's Jesus, right? People have been fighting as to whether Jesus is the Son of God. They still doing that mess, right? But we know for sure that where we were, we are not there anymore, because Jesus lifted us out of that. Amen? Amen. Amen. And while I'm thinking about that, I would be remiss if I don't ask the fellowship here to pray for our brothers and sisters in Israel, to pray that they will have a victory over their enemies. Sure, we pray for unity and togetherness, but we know that we have to stand with God's chosen people, the people of Israel. So be bold and encouraging to the world out there that want to think that it's not right to pray for Israel. We will, and we'll do it right now. Dear Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, you said in Genesis, you will bless those who bless you. You would curse those who cursed you. And they will receive a blessing, those that bless Israel. And so we lift up Israel, dear Heavenly Father, because we know the truth. We know, according to your word, that they are your chosen people. And so, dear Heavenly Father, we pray that they will be victorious. We pray that the enemy will flee and be on the run, dear Heavenly Father. Like what the pastor read this morning when David said, my enemy comes against me, but I know I will have the victory in the name of Jesus. And so, Father, we lift up Israel to you. Amen? And amen. And amen. The face of God. Here's something. Seek him with all your heart. The face of God. If you do, you will find him. The face of God. Seek his strength. The face of God. He is never far from you. In fact, if you are a believer, the indwelling of your Holy Spirit, of his Holy Spirit, have put you right there with him in the name of Jesus. I took a little twist and looked at Psalm 28 from different versions of the Bible, different Bibles, translations. And I looked at it from the King James Version. It says, when thou sayest, seek my face, my heart said unto thee, thy face, Lord, will I seek. Now that long psalm that the pastor read early on, David was praying to the Lord. And that is one message he got from the Lord. The Lord told him, seek my face. Amen. Then I look in the NIV. The NIV says, my heart says of you, seek his face. Your face, Lord, will I seek. Ha! Your face, Lord, will I seek. Then the Message Bible says, when my heart whispered, seek God, my whole being replied, I'm seeking him. Then the NLT says, my heart has heard what you've said. Come and talk with me. And my heart responded, Lord, I am coming. And then Psalm 27 from the Good Word, it says, what you said? Sounds like a brother talking, huh? What you said? Seek my face. And my heart said to you, oh Lord, I will seek your face. Have you responded to the Lord? Have you responded in your prayer and times when you're on your knees, when you're crying before the Lord and he's given you a message and he said, seek me. Seek me, seek me. Have you responded like David? Lord, your face I will seek. Amen? Amen. I'm still going around a circle. I'm only about maybe a half an inch around that circle. But I will continue. You know, in the Old Testament, people always attributed physical attributes to God. For example, like God's hand, God's feet, God's mouth, God's arm. We always have a tendency as human beings to do that for our great God and King because our physical, our mental is very limited on how we can praise or how we can describe Almighty God. And this is what they found, the problem they found in the Old Testament. And so they gave physical attributes to God. Let's look at feet. I'm thinking about Adam and Eve in that garden where the devil said, if you eat of the fruit of knowledge of good and evil, surely you won't die. And then I hear the writer saying that God entered the garden, and he called out to Adam and Eve. In fact, this is what they said. The Lord was walking. The feet, again, the Lord was walking. Now we know that God is everywhere at all times in anything and everything. But because of our limited expressions, we attributed a physical attribute. We said God was walking in the garden. Folks, I can say that today as we speak right now, that God is walking through Hope Center of Christ. Don't you see him? Don't you feel him? Don't you know he's there? So it's not far-fetched from those physical attributes of walking and talking and hands and all of that, because God is all, and he's all to us. Amen? Feet. Then we get to, my goodness gracious, let me move on, or I'll be here forever. Let's go about the hands. What does the hand of God indicate in physical terms? Put your hands to the plow. Work. 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 And we see this in the story of Nehemiah, where Nehemiah is the cupbearer for this great king. And Nehemiah is very saddened in his heart because he heard news about the city of God, Jerusalem, being torn down and in disrepair. But he knew that he could not stand sadly in front of the king because the king could take his life. But being that Nehemiah had been with the king so long, like we've with some of our spouses so long, they can recognize when something is wrong. And so the king asked Nehemiah, "What's wrong, Nehemiah?" Nehemiah tells him about the story and about the walls in Jerusalem, about his ancestors' grounds being destroyed. And he went to the Lord, and the Lord gave him his divine hand. It says, and may I have a letter? This is Nehemiah talking to the king. And may I have a letter to the keeper of the royal park so he will give me timber to make beams for the gates of the citadel by the temple and for the city wall and for the residence I will occupy. And because the divine hand of my God was on me, the king granted my request. As sure as you're sitting here today, I believe that God's divine hand is on each and every one of us. If you believe it, receive it. Amen. Amen. Boy, when I said that, I thought about Cain and Abel, the first murder that took place in the Bible. One brother killing another brother. Man, that was a joke there I wanted to say, but I won't keep it out. One brother killing another brother. We got to cut that mess out. But anyway, Cain decided to leave the presence of Almighty God. Because of his treacherous act, because of his murderous act, he hid himself from the presence of God. He did not hide God from him because God saw him hiding, but he did hide himself from God. And folks, we can do that. We can do that. But that's not a good place to be. We always want to stay in God's presence. That is why repentance is so important. When you ask for forgiveness and when you repent, you're putting yourself in the presence of God, and God is going to see you through. We all fail. We all fall. We all have trials. We all have doubts. We all have insecurities. But by the grace of God and the power of repentance and the power of forgiveness and the power of love, we can stand in the face of God. Amen. I wish someone had told Cain that, but they didn't. Now I want to move on over through the Old Testament to the book of Ecclesiastes. We're talking about working again. And this was a painful one for me, and probably for some of you, because you toil and toil and toil and toil and toil. You try to have a good life. You try to amass a fortune. You try to get a beautiful home. But Solomon says he noticed that people that did that, they had the same outcome as a fool. They all died. And not just that, the things that you have amassed, the things that you have built, will one day go to someone who either care or don't care about what you did. So we have to keep our hands in the hands of the Lord. Solomon sought out pleasure. He had concubines. He had a harem. He built strong buildings, big buildings. He had many cattle on a lot of hills. A lot of hills. And he drops to his knees and he asks his Lord, what is this thing about life? What is this thing? Why I can't receive it? Why I can't get it from pleasures and the things that I've done? And here's what Solomon, the conclusion he comes to. He says, a person can do nothing better than to eat and drink and find satisfaction in their own toil. This too I see is from the hand of God. Now we're talking about this pandemic, and everywhere I ride around, I see help wanted signs. I don't even see the guy on the corner anymore. Please feed me. I need a job. I don't see that right now. People are thinking that handouts is the way to go. But handouts don't build character. Handouts don't build stamina. Handouts are not what God meant for his children to be about. The scriptures say, if you don't work, you don't eat. You think God knew something more than we? I think so. I think so. You know, I think the young people out there are being probably influenced more by the thought of not working and be on the part of being the recipient or receiving. And I can't blame them for believing the way that they believe, because we've had a lot of ministries, a lot of churches that are not preaching the true word of God. The word of God said, work and you will eat. Not eat, and someone else works. That's not the way it goes. And you know what, folks? The young people know that. But as long as believers, as long as pastors, as long as people in authority indoctrinate their minds that all they have to do is to receive, they are going to do it. And that hurts, because God has put his will, his vision, his attributes in us as individual. And through those imparting attributes and character that God has put into us, he wants to see them blossom into a beautiful flower to change the world, to change the life for the better, to find a cure for cancer, to find a peaceful solution, to find harmony and peace. The young folks want that, but we're not preaching it from the pulpit. We're trying to fill our churches with bodies on these pews, and God could care less about a body being on a pew if we're not seeking his face, if we're not telling the truth to our youth, to our children. Amen. I fear the day if you bring up the name Jesus Christ and a kid says, well, who is that? Who is that? Oh, he's just a prophet. That's what I was taught. No. Not if you went to Hope Center of Christ. You are taught that Jesus is the mighty Son of God who went to that cross at Calvary, who died for you and this world so that you may have life and have it more abundantly, and that you can become all things because of the power of Almighty God. Amen. Let's teach it. My goodness. I was reading about the Epicureans. I don't know. The Lord just gave me that reading assignment to read about the Epicureans. The Epicureans, they were around when David and Moses and Christ and Paul and all of them, and all they taught about was just enjoy yourself. Just have pleasure. There's only two things in life, pain and pleasure. And once you are gone, you are gone. Young folks, don't buy that mess, because there is life after death. My scripture says when you're absent from the body, you're present with the Lord. Your only decision has to be, who is your Lord? Is he Beelzebub, or is he God Almighty who sacrificed his son Jesus Christ that we may have life and have it more abundantly? Amen. Amen. Let the Lord know you love him. Then they talk about the arm of God. The arm of God. My boys, when they were young, they always wanted me to look at their arms. They said, Dad, I got a muscle here. I got a muscle. Why was it important for them to show me they had a muscle? Because that arm, that muscle represents strength. And so when their early believers in the scripture put this attribute towards God as being armed, they was talking about his strength, his refuge, his might, his power. You see, they had not yet got to understand what we know. Jesus. Amen. We find our refuge and security in God. He keeps us from collapsing. You get some terrible news. You find yourself in a tragedy. You find yourself bewildered by some storm or circumstance in your life. Well, call on that arm of Jesus. He will keep you from collapsing. He will support you and keep you up. Amen. Can I get a testimony in here? Is there someone in here that knows what I'm talking about? If you know what I'm talking about, shout hallelujah. 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 Amen and amen. Oh, the battle is not yours. It is the Lord. So seek him. Be like David. Seek him. Be like David. David had everything. David is the one that slew Goliath. David is the one who became king. He had a wonderful priest. Zadok was his priest. But even Zadok could not fill that emptiness that David had. And David had this emptiness because he knew he had a God, but he never had a chance to see his face. He was in the presence of God, but he didn't have a chance to see his face. Now, folks, you know, I have a beautiful wife, right? But if she was to go on the East Coast and you bring me a picture to remind me of how beautiful she is, I would say, that's okay. But I want to see her presence. I want to hear her voice. I want to see her beauty. I want to see her character. I want to see her walk. I want to see her cry. I want to see her joy. That is why we seek the face of God. We want to see God's power. We want to see how he's manifested in our lives. We want to see him. We want to know him. We want to know him. The presence is okay, but we want to see his face. Amen. 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 There is no one like God. No one. Now let's get to the message. All right. Are you ready? How are those chairs out there? You're burning your buns? Well, let's call on the name of Jesus. Help them out, Lord. Help them out. You know what? God is beautiful, guys. He is so beautiful. He is so beautiful. Each and every one of us, we think that we are in the church. But right now, we are in the presence of God. We're in the presence of God. We are sitting here thinking that we are just individuals. But we are more than that. We are the temple of Almighty God. Can you imagine when that truth dawns on you, that little saying about God knows how many apples will come from a seed, but we only know the number of seeds in an apple? Do you know how powerful that will become when you realize that you are the temple of God? That seed is in you. How many apples are you going to produce? How many? There is no limit of what each and every one of us can do if we realize and act upon that truth that we are the temple of God, that his presence resides in us. And he expects us to do a great and mighty work. The chief call of everything is the face of God. And because Jesus Christ came to earth, we got to see the face of God. Moses asked God, "Let me see your face." God said, "Moses, if you see my face, you would die." God was too radiant, too beautiful, too expansive. But he did allow Moses to see his back. Amen. And Moses was a warrior like none other. And he cried out, "Lord, let me see your face." "Not now, Moses. You can't stand it." But thank God for Jesus. Thank God for Jesus. He is and was and will be everything that God has been and will be. Amen. The face of God. Folks, you've seen it. You've seen it. Don't deny it. You've seen the face of God. I know I've seen the face of God in doing this message. My goodness, I saw the face of God. It was a struggle to do this message. But because of you temples that are out there, you are giving me the message to give to you that God has given to me to have. Now that don't make no sense at all to me, but it makes sense to somebody. Amen. 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 The face of God. Oh my goodness. Thank you so much. And just as I said that, I thought about my little grandson that passed away at about 12 months old. I didn't like that little turkey, man. I didn't like that little turkey because he was conceived in wedlock, and it wasn't the way that I wanted him to be born. And so I did not hate him, but it was hard for me to embrace him. And when he passed away, I realized that he had been a face of God to show me I had some growing up to do. I had a whole lot of growing up to do. Amen? God worked in mysterious ways, folks. But he gets your attention. He teaches you. He trains you. So I'm going to do my little cliff note right now because I think I've been speaking for about 5 minutes. And so, see, I said that so I could get a feedback. I told you, y'all teach me, see? I tell you. So when you see the face of God and when you're walking in the face of God, remember, you have received his salvation. When you're walking in the face of God, remember, there you can find rest. When you're walking and when you're seeking and when you're basking in the face of God, you can have all the power that you need for any circumstance or situation. When you see the face of God, make sure you realize that you have all the protection you need against this world and any enemy in this world. When you're in the face of God, be jubilant because he gives you much joy. Joy fills your soul. Joy fills your heart. There's unspeakable joy when you're in the face of Almighty God. When you're in the face of God, you don't have to walk through this world wimpy and hoping for some spinach to make you strong, because God is all the strength that you need. He is the courage that you need. Amen? Amen. Let's go on with the cliff note. You always want to stay in the presence of God. You always want to be in his face. You always want to see his face. But there are things that will keep you from that. Not obeying him will prohibit that. You will receive destruction if you're out of the face of God. And drum roll, please. Sin will definitely keep you out of the face of God. Because when you're sinning, you're hiding. When you're not asking for repentance or forgiveness, you chose to stay in that sin. Seek God's face. Seek his face, the face of God. So, what do I want you to do? Well, I'm glad you asked. I want you to make a commitment today to dwell in the presence of God. I want you to make a decision today to discover God's will for your life. Not your will, but his will for your life. And it is being revealed to you, but don't step it down. Don't stomp it down. Don't stop. Just do it. Even if you're afraid to do it. Remember Gideon. He had 10,000 soldiers. God said, no. They'll get the glory. Then he had a few hundred. God said, no. That's too many. He ended up with 300. So folks, Discover God's will on your life. It may frighten you that he said, I want you. And you said, me? That's too big for me. It can't be me. You know when God touches you, don't be afraid. Allow him to use you. And delight in his character that he has put in you. Rejoice in that character that he has put in you. Don't strap it down. Don't hold it back. Delight in the character that God has given you. And seek him. So, okay, I've shared what I would like for you to do. And I don't think I would be good if I didn't share how you can do this. First, you want to look to the Lord and his strength and seek his face always. Next, abide in him. The psalm says, for the Lord is righteous. He loves justice. The upright will see his face. So abide in him. Next, this is the how. Pray. Let your face shine on your servant. Save me from your unfailing love. So pray. How do you get in the face of God? You look.
I don't want to see it.
You look into the face of God. What you going to find there, folks? You're going to find love. What you going to find there, folks? You're going to find joy. What you going to find there, folks? You're going to find forgiveness. What you going to find, folks? You're going to find peace. What you going to find there, folks? You're going to find health. What you going to find there, folks? You're going to find eternal life. Because you've chosen to live for Almighty God. And finally, obey. Obey him. Obeying God is a very important ingredient. It is. It is. The battle is not yours. It's the Lord. In our world today, there's a force. It's not new, but it's a force that's warring with Almighty God, and it has been warring for a long time. But its time is coming to an end. You remain faithful to Almighty God. You obey his word. And when you recognize that demon that's trying to separate you from your Almighty God, you stomp him and you put him up under the blood of Jesus. Amen. 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 See God's face. Become more like him. And I just like to finish with Jeremiah 29, verses 11 to 14. This is God talking about you, temples. This is what God says about you, believers. This is what God says about you, his children. He says, for I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you. Plans to give you a future and a hope. Oh, then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and he says, I will listen. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all, not some, seek me with all. Seek me with all your heart. He said, and I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity. I got to stop there. I'm sorry. I was going to close, but I just want us to understand the Bible is not old. The Bible is, in some cases, just being birthed to some people. But the Bible isn't old. When it talks about, I will bring you out of captivity, and we look at that Old Testament, we see God's people taken into Egypt, or God's people ravaged and taken off into a foreign land, and God said, I will release you from your captivity. Folks, we are being captive today. Some of us being captive today. So don't say, oh, pity them Old Testament characters. Pity us that don't know the Lord and don't know we need a deliverance and don't know that we've been delivered and we continue to walk in darkness. We continue to walk in ignorance. We're being captive. The war is going on, but the battle is not yours. It's the Lord's. My goodness, thank you, Lord. He says, I will gather you from all the nations and places where I have banished you, declared the Lord, and will bring you back to the place from which I carried you into exile. Folks, connect with the power of God. Open, 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 open. I don't know about you, but when someone knocks at my door and I open it, the first thing I do is look at their face. The face of God. Open, open, in the name of Jesus. Dear Heavenly Father, we are so thankful to you. We praise your name, dear Heavenly Father. We ask that you would give us the courage to constantly stare in your face, knowing that all that we need, all that we will become, all that we will ever have resides with you, Father. Dear God, you are wonderful and wonderful, wonderful and worthy to be praised. In the name of Jesus, amen. You may stand for the benediction. Temples of God. God is your path to life. In his presence is joy. And in his right hand, there are pleasures forevermore. Receive God. Look into his face. Go in peace. Amen. Thank you.
For our closing song, go ahead and turn in your songbooks to page 53, For the Lord is My Light. Again, that's page 53.
Thank you, Pastor Harold. Yes. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Amen. Hallelujah.
secret place where I see God's face. He gives me peace from my troubled mind. He carries me, comforts me when I'm going through the storm. Out of the reach of them all. When my enemy tried to hurt me, I don't have to worry. I'm in his care, not just here, but everywhere. I go to that hiding place where I see my God's face. That he carries me
over mountains high,
comforts me
over valleys low,
when I'm going through the storm.
Going through the storm.
Hallelujah. God bless you. We'll see you next week.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.